The last video focused on double replacement reactions. These were reactions where compounds swapped ions. The general formula was AB plus CD yields AD plus CB. If you'd like to see more of that, there is a link to the playlist in the description. But this video is going to focus on a specific type of double replacement reaction. We're going to look at precipitation reactions. A precipitation reaction is one that forms a precipitate, and a precipitate is a solid that forms during a chemical reaction. Very often in a double replacement reactions, one of the products is something that is not soluble in water, so it forms a solid. It comes out of the solution and forms a solid. We have a tool that helps us to determine when a precipitate will form, and that tool is the solubility rules. Here is one version of the solubility rules. This is a list of ions that tend to be soluble. For example, chlorides, bromides, and iodides tend to be soluble unless they are paired with silver, lead, or mercury. This is a list of ions that tend to be insoluble, meaning they would form a solid. So these ions tend to not form a solid. They're soluble in water. They dissolve in water. These ions tend to form a solid. A precipitate would form. Let's look at an example. This is sodium fluoride. Notice that all of the rules deal with anions. These are negatively charged ions that are found at the end of the compound. So in my example, sodium fluoride, I'm trying to find a rule about the fluorides, and that rule is here. It tells me that all of the fluorides are soluble except group 2, lead 2, and iron 3. Because sodium is not one of the exceptions, then sodium fluoride is soluble. We would put AQ beside sodium fluoride to let the reader know that this was an aqueous compound. A precipitate did not form, it was soluble, it did dissolve in water. Consider another example, silver chloride. Once again, focus on the second ion in the compound, the chlorides. Here is the rule about the chlorides. It says chlorides are soluble except silver. Silver chloride is one of the exceptions, so that kicks it over to this side. Silver chloride is insoluble. Something that is insoluble does not dissolve in water, a solid would form. So you would put the state of matter to be S for solid. Another example would be lithium hydroxide. Once again, focus on the anion. So we're looking for a rule about the hydroxides. That rule is here. It says your hydroxides are insoluble except group 1, strontium, barium, and ammonium. So you should ask yourself, is lithium in group 1, or is it strontium, barium, or ammonium? Lithium is in group 1 on the periodic table, so lithium hydroxide is one of the exceptions. Even though you find the hydroxides here, the fact that it's one of the exceptions throws it back over to here. Lithium hydroxide is soluble. You would put AQ to indicate that it was aqueous. It does dissolve in water. A precipitate does not form. Now that we've seen how the solubility rules work, let's take a look at some precipitation reactions. These look like double replacement reactions, so the first thing that you should do is to predict the products of the reaction following this general pattern. So in this case, I've got lead nitrate, lead is my A, nitrate is my B, with potassium iodide, that's my C and D. So I can see here that the lead is my A, is going to end up with iodide. So on the right-hand side of the reaction, I should have lead iodide plus what's left over is potassium nitrate. And now that you have your products predicted, it's time to go to the solubility rules and determine if either one of these compounds would form a precipitate. So focus on the second ion in the compound, find a rule about the iodides. It tells me that all chlorides, bromides, and iodides are soluble except silver, lead, and mercury. Lead is one of the exceptions. So this compound is insoluble. It would form a precipitate. And I have indicated that by listing an S for the state of matter. Now we focus on the other compound. Find a rule about nitrate. It says that all nitrates, acetates, and ammoniums, and all group 1A salts are soluble, and there are no exceptions. So all nitrates are soluble. This compound does dissolve in water, and you would list AQ as the state of matter. At this point, my precipitation reaction is complete. You can see that an aqueous solution plus another aqueous solution formed a solid solution plus another aqueous solution. In a lab environment, these aqueous solutions would be liquid solutions that you would pour together, and you would actually see a cloudy substance start to form and fall out of the solution. That cloudy substance would be your precipitate. That's the solid that's forming during your chemical reaction. Let's do another example. This time, barium hydroxide is combined with potassium sulfate. This is a double replacement reaction, and we're going to predict the products. So barium is going to end up with sulfate. Remember that A ended up with D. So we have barium sulfate, and the other product is going to be potassium with hydroxide. At this point, you're ready to go to your solubility rules and determine which one of these might be a precipitate. Remember to focus on the second ion in the compound, so we want to find a rule about the sulfates. Here it is. It says all sulfates are soluble except for calcium, strontium, barium, mercury, lead, and silver. So this is one of the exceptions. So it is insoluble. We need to list solid as the state of matter. The other compound, potassium hydroxide, we should find a rule about the hydroxides. It says all hydroxides are insoluble except for group 1. Potassium is in group 1. So this is one of the exceptions. Potassium hydroxide is soluble, and we need to put AQ to indicate that it has dissolved in water. The precipitation reactions that we just wrote are considered molecular equations. A molecular equation shows you the compounds that are present and their state of matter. There's a lot of information given to you there. The fact that barium hydroxide is aqueous means that those ions, the ions that make up barium hydroxide, have broken apart and dissolved into the water. So a complete ionic equation shows that process. You can see that barium hydroxide, because it is aqueous, gets broken apart into barium and hydroxide ions. When you write a complete ionic equation, you should include the charges for each of the ions present. The number of ions present is also reflected. There were 2 hydroxide ions for every 1 barium ion. So here, there are 2 hydroxide ions. That subscript has become a coefficient. Potassium sulfate was also aqueous. So in a complete ionic equation, that shows up as 2 potassium ions and 1 sulfate ion. Barium sulfate is our solid. In a complete ionic equation, barium sulfate, your solids stay together. Potassium hydroxide, once again, is aqueous, so we break it apart into its ions. Notice that the reaction is balanced, so there needed to be 2 of each of those to balance the reaction. In a complete ionic equation, there are often ions that show up on both sides of the reaction exactly the same. These are ions that did not participate in the chemistry. We call them spectator ions. They were simply watching the chemical reaction take place. There's another type of equation called a net ionic equation. A net ionic equation leaves out those spectator ions. So once you've written your complete ionic equation, you start crossing out any ions that stay the same on both sides. For example, hydroxide shows up here and here. There are two of them, two hydroxide ions, on each side of the equation, so we can cross those out. There are also two potassium ions on each side of the equation. We can cross those out. Notice that the sulfate ion is present on the left, but on the right, sulfate is part of barium sulfate. It's part of a compound. That's different. I can't cross out sulfate, and I can't cross out barium. What remains is called my net ionic equation. The net ionic equation shows you the chemistry that actually took place. The other ions that are not present in the net ionic equation are spectator ions. They simply watched the chemistry take place. They did not participate. So just to recap, the equation that you write when you're doing your double replacement reaction and then you identify your precipitate, that is your molecular equation. From your molecular equation, you can write a complete ionic equation. To do that, any substance that is aqueous gets broken apart into its ions. Any substance that is solid or liquid stays together. And then you start looking for things that can be canceled out. You cancel out anything that is exactly the same on both sides of the reaction. What remains is your net ionic equation. That completes double replacement reactions and precipitation reactions. Stick around as we look at our last type of reaction, which are combustion reactions.